Hey guys, Rob Skiba here. I was just browsing on YouTube and I stumbled across a very interesting video. Now, many of you have heard the famous JFK speech, or at least a portion of the famous JFK speech, where he says, "We choose to go to the moon and do the other thing, not because they are easy, but because they are hard." Right? We've heard that, right? But you haven't heard the whole thing, at least probably most of you haven't. So I'm going to go ahead and play that for you now, the whole speech, and then we'll come back and talk about some things that I found out about at a conference that I was in. I was out in Lubbock this past weekend and learned something that frankly blew my mind. So I'm going to share it with you here right after this.
President Pitzer, Mr. Vice President, Governor, Congressman Thomas, Senator Wiley and Congressman Miller, Mr. Webb, Mr. Bell, scientists, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I appreciate your president having made me an honorary visiting professor, and I will assure you that my first lecture will be very brief. I am delighted to be here, and I'm particularly delighted to be here on this occasion. We meet at a college noted for knowledge, in a city noted for progress, in a state noted for strength, and we stand in need of all three. For we meet in an hour of change and challenge, in a decade of hope and fear, in an age of both knowledge and ignorance. The greater our knowledge increases, the greater our ignorance unfolds. Despite the striking fact that most of the scientists that the world has ever known are alive and working today, despite the fact that this nation's own scientific manpower is doubling every 12 years in a rate of growth more than three times that of our population as a whole, despite that, the vast stretches of the unknown and the unanswered and the unfinished still far outstrip our collective comprehension. No man can fully grasp how far and how fast we have come. But condense, if you will, the 50,000 years of man's recorded history in a time span of but a half a century. Stated in these terms, we know very little about the first 40 years, except at the end of them, advanced man had learned to use the skins of animals to cover them. Then about 10 years ago, under this standard, man emerged from his caves to construct other kinds of shelter. Only 5 years ago, man learned to write and use a cart with wheels. Christianity began less than 2 years ago. The printing press came this year. And then less than 2 months ago, during this whole 50-year span of human history, the steam engine provided a new source of power. Newton explored the meaning of gravity. Last month, electric lights and telephones and automobiles and airplanes became available. Only last week did we develop penicillin and television and nuclear power. And now, if America's new spacecraft succeeds in reaching Venus, we will have literally reached the stars before midnight tonight. This is a breathtaking pace, and such a pace cannot help but create new ills as it dispels old. New ignorance, new problems, new dangers. Surely the opening vistas of space promise high costs and hardships as well as high reward. So it is not surprising that some would have us stay where we are a little longer, to rest, to wait. But this city of Houston, this state of Texas, this country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested and wished to look behind them. This country was conquered by those who move forward, and so will space. William Bradford, speaking in 1630 of the founding of the Plymouth Bay Colony, said that all great and honorable actions are accompanied with great difficulties, and both must be enterprised and overcome with answerable courage. If this capsule history of our progress teaches us anything, it is that man in his quest for knowledge and progress is determined and cannot be deterred. The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not. And it is one of the great adventures of all time. And no nation which expects to be the leader of other nations can expect to stay behind in this race for space. Those who came before us made certain that this country rode the first waves of the Industrial Revolution, the first waves of modern invention, and the first wave of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backwash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead it. For the eyes of the world now look into space, to the moon and to the planets beyond. And we have vowed that we shall not see it governed by a hostile flag of conquest, but by a banner of freedom and peace. We have vowed that we shall not see space filled with weapons of mass destruction, but with instruments of knowledge and understanding. Yet the vows of this nation can only be fulfilled if we in this nation are first, and therefore we intend to be first. In short, our leadership in science and industry, our hopes for peace and security, our obligations to ourselves as well as others, all require us to make this effort to solve these mysteries, to solve them for the good of all men, and to become the world's leading spacefaring nation. We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won, and they must be won and used for the progress of all people. For space science, like nuclear science and all technology, has no conscience of its own. Whether it will become a force for good or ill depends on man. And only if the United States occupies a position of preeminence can we help decide whether this new ocean will be a sea of peace or a new terrifying theater of war. I do not say that we should or will go unprotected against the hostile misuse of space any more than we go unprotected against the hostile use of land or sea. But I do say that space can be explored and mastered without feeding the fires of war, without repeating the mistakes that man has made in extending his writ around this globe of ours. There is no strife, no prejudice, no national conflict in outer space as yet. Its hazards are hostile to us all. Its conquest deserves the best of all mankind. And its opportunity for peaceful cooperation may never come again. But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills, because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too. It is for these reasons that I regard the decision last year to shift our efforts in space from low to high gear as among the most important decisions that will be made during my incumbency in the office of the presidency. In the last 24 hours, we have seen facilities now being created for the greatest and most complex exploration in man's history. We have felt the ground shake and the air shattered by the testing of a Saturn C-1 booster rocket, many times as powerful as the Atlas which launched John Glenn, generating power equivalents to 10,000 automobiles with their accelerator on the floor. We have seen the site where five F-1 rocket engines, each one as powerful as all eight engines of the Saturn combined, will be clustered together to make the advanced Saturn missile, assembled in a new building to be built at Cape Canaveral, as tall as a 48-story structure, as wide as a city block, and as long as two lengths of this field. Within these last 19 months, at least 45 satellites have circled the Earth. Some 40 of them were made in the United States of America, and they were far more sophisticated and supplied far more knowledge to the people of the world than those of the Soviet Union. The Mariner spacecraft, the Mariner spacecraft now on its way to Venus, is the most intricate instrument in the history of space science. The accuracy of that shot is comparable to firing a missile from Cape Canaveral and dropping it in this stadium between the 40-yard lines. Transit satellites are helping our ships at sea to steer a safer course. Tyrus satellites have given us unprecedented warnings of hurricanes and storms, and will do the same for forest fires and icebergs. We have had our failures, but so have others, even if they do not admit them, and they may be less public. To be sure, we are behind, and will be behind for some time in manned flight. But we do not intend to stay behind, and in this decade, we shall make up and move ahead. The growth of our science and education will be enriched by new knowledge of our universe and environment, by new techniques of learning and mapping and observation, by new tools and computers for industry, medicine, and the home, as well as the school. Technical institutions such as Rice will reap the harvest of these gains. And finally, the space effort itself, while still in its infancy, has already created a great number of new companies and tens of thousands of new jobs. Space and related industries are generating new demands in investment and skilled personnel, and this city and this state and this region will share greatly in this growth. What was once the furthest outpost on the old frontier of the West will be the furthest outpost on the new frontier of science and space. Houston, your city of Houston, with its manned spacecraft center, will become the heart of a large scientific and engineering community. During the next 5 years, the National Aeronautic and Space Administration expects to double the number of scientists and engineers in this area, to increase its outlays for salaries and expenses to $60 million a year, to invest some $200 million in plant and laboratory facilities, and to direct or contract for new space efforts over $1 billion from this center in this city. To be sure, all this costs us all a good deal of money. This year's space budget is three times what it was in January 1961. And it is greater than the space budget of the previous 8 years combined. That budget now stands at $5,400,000,000 a year. A staggering sum, though somewhat less than we pay for cigarettes and cigars every year. Space expenditures. Space expenditures will soon rise some more, from 40 cents per person per week to more than 50 cents a week for every man, woman, and child in the United States. For we have given this program a high national priority, even though I realize that this is, in some measure, an act of faith and vision. For we do not now know what benefits await us. But if I were to say, my fellow citizens, that we shall send to the moon, 240,000 miles away from the control station in Houston, a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, the length of this football field, made of new metal alloys, some of which have not yet been invented, capable of standing heat and stresses, several times more than have ever been experienced, fitted together with a precision better than the finest watch, carrying all the equipment needed for propulsion, guidance, control, communications, food, and survival, on an untried mission to an unknown celestial body, and then return it safely to Earth, re-entering the atmosphere at speeds of over 25,000 miles per hour, causing heat about half that on the temperature of the sun, almost as hot as it is here today, and do all this, and do all this, and do it right, and do it first. Before this decade is out, then we must be bold. I'm the one who's doing all the work, so we're just going to stay cool for a minute. However, I think we're going to do it. And I think that we must pay what needs to be paid. I don't think we ought to waste any money, but I think we ought to do the job. And this will be done in the decade of the 60s. It may be done while some of you are still here at school at this college and university. It will be done during the terms of office of some of the people who sit here on this platform. But it will be done. And it will be done before the end of this decade. And I am delighted that this university is playing a part in putting a man on the moon as part of a great national effort of the United States of America. Many years ago, the great British explorer George Mallory, who was to die on Mount Everest, was asked why did he want to climb it. He said, because it is there. Well, space is there, and we're going to climb it. And the moon and the planets are there, and new hopes for knowledge and peace are there. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
So that speech took place on September 12, 1962 at Rice University. Now, hopefully you're already caught up to speed on some of the videos that I've been producing regarding the Flat Earth controversy, specifically related to activity down in Antarctica. If you're not, you're going to need to get up to speed a little bit here. Go ahead and hit pause on this video if you're not familiar with Admiral Byrd and specifically the missions High Jump, Operation High Jump, and Operation Deep Freeze. If you're not familiar with those things, hit pause in this video and go get caught up on that. You know, you could watch Mark Sargent's video, The Bird Wall. I think it's his Flat Earth Clues number 2 video. Or go through my videos and look through that, or just do a Google search on it. Okay, so get caught up to speed on that. So let me go ahead and punch up my screen share here. All right, so Admiral Byrd goes down there, Operation High Jump, 1946 through 47, and Operation Deep Freeze, 1955 through 56. Then he dies on March 11th, 1957. Then the Antarctic Treaty takes place shortly after his death. We see that the main treaty was open for signature on December 1st, 1959, and officially entered into force on June 23rd, 1961. Meanwhile, okay, let's put the chronology here. You got, again, Operation High Jump 46 through 47, Operation Deep Freeze 55 to 56. He dies in 57. NASA's formed in 1958. Then, after Operation Deep Freeze and whatever weirdness took place down there, everybody leaves there, leaves Antarctica, and they go and form this Antarctic Treaty and put that into place in 1961. The original signatories were the 12 countries active in Antarctica during the International Geophysical Year 1957 to 58. The 12 countries that had significant interests in Antarctica at the time were Argentina, Australia, Belgium, Chile, France, Japan, New Zealand, Norway, South Africa, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, and of course the United States. These countries had established over 50 Antarctic stations for the International Geophysical Year. The treaty was a diplomatic expression of the operational and scientific cooperation that had been achieved on the ice. Something happened down there after Operation Deep Freeze, and presumably about the time that Admiral Byrd died. So all these nations that I just talked about here, they leave there, they come back, they sign this Antarctic Treaty at the same time NASA's formed, and right away, the United States and Russia start launching high-altitude nuclear bombs in the atmosphere. Now, I can see why the people will put on a conspiracy hat at this point, because if they're trying to avoid a conspiracy, they're not helping with the names. You've heard me say it before. I'm going to say it again. You know, you got Operation High Jump, Operation Deep Freeze. NASA's formed, they signed this Antarctic Treaty, and then when you look at the high-altitude nuclear bomb tests that begin here, I'm going to go ahead and read Operation Dominic here. Operation Dominic was a series of 31 nuclear test explosions with a 38.1 megaton total yield conducted in 1962 by the United States in the Pacific. This test series was scheduled quickly in order to respond in kind to the Soviet resumption of testing after the tacit 1958 to 61 test moratorium. Most of these shots were conducted with free fall bombs dropped from B-52 bomber aircraft. 20 of these shots were to test new weapons designs, 6 to test weapons effects, and several shots to confirm the reliability of existing weapons. The Thor missile was also used to lift warheads into near space to conduct high-altitude nuclear explosion tests. These shots were collectively called Operation Fishbowl. Operation Dominic occurred during a period of high Cold War tension between the United States and the Soviet Union, since the Cuban Bay of Pigs invasion had occurred not long before. Nikita Khrushchev announced the end of a 3-year moratorium on nuclear testing on 30 August 1961, and Soviet tests recommenced on 1 September, initiating a series of tests that included the detonation of Tsar Bomba. President John F. Kennedy responded by authorizing Operation Dominic. It was the largest nuclear weapons testing program ever conducted by the United States and the last atmospheric test series conducted by the U.S. as the Limited Test Ban Treaty was signed in Moscow the following year. Now, check this out. If you click on Operation Fishbowl, we learn about Operation Fishbowl here. It was a series of high-altitude nuclear tests in 1962 that were carried out by the United States as part of the larger Operation Dominic nuclear test program. The Operation Fishbowl nuclear tests were originally planned to be completed during the first half of 1962, with 3 tests named Bluegill, Starfish, and Araka. The first test attempt was delayed until June. Planning for Operation Fishbowl, as well as many other nuclear tests in the region, was begun rapidly in response to the sudden Soviet announcement on 30 August 1961 that they were ending a 3-year moratorium on nuclear testing. The rapid planning of very complex operations necessitated many changes as the project progressed. All of the tests were to be launched on missiles from Johnston Island in the Pacific Ocean north of the equator. Johnston Island had already been established as a launch site for United States high-altitude nuclear tests rather than the other locations in the Pacific Proving Grounds. In 1958, Louis Strauss, then chairman of the United States Atomic Energy Commission, opposed doing any high-altitude tests at locations that had been used for earlier Pacific nuclear tests. His opposition was because of fears that the flash from the nighttime high-altitude detonations might blind civilians who were living on nearby islands. Johnston Island was a remote location more distant from populated areas than other potential test locations. In order to protect residents of the Hawaiian Islands from flash blindness or permanent retinal injury from the bright nuclear flash, the nuclear missiles of Operation Fishbowl were launched generally toward the southwest of Johnston Island so that the detonations would be farther from Hawaii. Araka was to be a test of about 1 megaton yield at very high altitude, above 1,000 kilometers. The proposed Araka test was always controversial, especially after the damage caused to satellites by the Starfish Prime detonation, as described below. Araka was finally canceled, and an extensive reevaluation of the Operation Fishbowl plan was made during an 82-day operations pause after the Bluegill Prime disaster of 25 July 1962, as described below. And you could go on and read about Kingfish and all this stuff. Okay, so we got Operation Dominic, within which we have Operation Fishbowl. Now, with the tinfoil hat on, playing conspiracy theory here, the flat earthers are claiming, and I think it's a reasonable claim, that, you know, if that model is true, then we know we have a circle, the circle of the earth as described in the Bible, surrounded by Antarctica, the outer rim, that has a 200 or 300 foot ice wall cliff that keeps everything in, hence Operation High Jump. You got to get over that, right? So it looks like, at least from the flat earther perspective, that probably during Operation Deep Freeze, they may have found the edge of the dome, presumably anywhere from 800 to 1200 miles inland from the coast. Then everybody pulls out, signs this treaty, says nobody can go back except under the express guidelines of the international community that signed the treaty. So then all of a sudden the United States and Russia engage in these high-altitude nuclear tests, and the United States calls theirs Operation Dominic, within which we have Operation Fishbowl. Now, hold that thought. This is all happening, if you go and look on the Operation Dominic entry, you see the different dates. We're 1962. This is the early part of 1962. We're talking May. I mean, look at all these bombs going off. 25 April, 1962, 27 April, 2 May, 4 May, 6 May, 8 May, 9 May, 11 May, 11 May, 12 May, 14 May, 19, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This is all before President Kennedy's "Let's go out in the space" speech. But I think a lot of people don't realize that our first stop wasn't the moon. Even before we went to the moon, they were sending probes all of a sudden after all of this. Okay, keep the timeline in mind. Operation High Jump, Operation Deep Freeze, Bird dies, NASA's founded, Antarctic Treaty signed, Operation Dominic and Fishbowl take effect. And if you notice during President Kennedy's speech, he was talking about that they've already got probes headed to Venus. Wait a minute. We're already sending stuff to Venus and Mars? We haven't even been to the moon yet. And so I was looking into that, and on planetary.org/explore/space/topics/space missions/missions-to-venus-mercury.html. And you can go through this site. It starts sort of from the bottom up. As early as February 4th, 1961, they're sending a probe, Sputnik 7. Russia sent this probe to check out Venus. The final stage of the rocket carrying Sputnik 7 into orbit failed, and the spacecraft was unable to achieve the necessary trajectory to carry it onto Venus. Then Venera 1, Russia, sends out another probe February 12, 1961. They lost communications while it was on its way to Venus. Then NASA sends up Mariner 1, July 22nd, 1962. Now, that's right in the middle of Dominic and Fishbowl, that we sent out a probe to go check out Venus. It veered off course and was destroyed by ground controllers. So then Russia sends up another one, Sputnik 19, August 25th, 1962. The spacecraft made it into orbit, but the rocket's last stage failed as Sputnik 19 was unable to achieve its Venus trajectory and re-entered the Earth's atmosphere 3 days later. NASA, August 27th, 1962. Sends its probe. It says Mariner 2 was the first spacecraft to successfully fly by Venus at an altitude of 34,773 kilometers. The spacecraft discovered ground temperatures, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so this is during the time period that between August 27th, 1962 and December 14th, 1962, that we had President Kennedy's speech in September, on September 12th, 1962. So that's what he's referring to. You know, we've already got stuff out there and you can read about the other ones that were, you know, checking out Venus, I guess Mercury also, and attempted probes going to Mars. Now, this is all before we've even been to the moon. So it appears that whatever happened in Antarctica, everybody got kind of maybe nervous or excited or whatever and said, okay, what is the deal? You know, we've looked through telescopes. We've seen our so-called neighbors, Venus and Mars, through telescopes. Our assumption is the solar system is, you know, set up in the Copernican model. And but yet maybe they found a dome and they started to question all that. So the first thing they do is send out probes to go, wait a minute. What in the world, if we're in a dome, how high does this thing go? So they start launching high altitude nuclear bombs. And if you look at the videos on Operation Fishbowl and Starfish Prime and all those high altitude tests, I mean, it looks like they're hitting something up there. At least from a conspiratorial tinfoil hat wearing perspective, that's what it looks like. Now, this is what blew my mind. You can read more on all that if you'd like. To get caught up to speed on what's going on there. So I go to Lubbock and I'm doing this conference out there at Jared Kressman's father's church, Pastor Dan Kressman. And we get to talking about this whole issue of the flat earth stuff. And he goes, do you know what the name Dominic means? And I said, no. He says, you know, you talk about Operation Fishbowl, but check this out. I'm going to take you to, I'll put the screen share back up here. Take you to a one of those name websites. I like using behindthename.com. Look up the name Dominic. And again, let's just double check it here. Dominic, D-O-M-I-N-I-C. Look up Dominic, D-O-M-I-N-I-C. From the late Latin name Dominicus, meaning of the Lord. Fishbowl was part of Operation Dominic. It looks like they are sending high-altitude nuclear bombs to test the fishbowl of the Lord, i.e. the firmament. Yeah, this is definitely one of those things to make you go,